want to start in the book of Psalms, and then I want to go to the book of Isaiah for a second tonight. The book of Psalms, chapter 103, verse number 1. Psalms 103, verse number 1. It says this: praise the Lord, O my soul. Somebody say soul. Your soul is your mind, your will, and your emotions. I love that the first thing David is just shouting out to his mind, his will, and his emotions: you better get up and praise him. Sometimes you got to talk to yourself. Somebody tell your neighbor, talk to yourself. Praise the Lord. Sometimes you got to tell yourself, I'm going to worship tonight. David would warn the sun, moon, and stars. You better be ready, because I'm going to speak to my soul for a second. He would say, I will praise the Lord. Sometimes you don't feel like praising the Lord. Sometimes you don't want to praise the Lord. But sometimes you got to serve notice on your feelings. I'm not talking about emotional worship based on how you feel when you feel good or when you feel bad. But I'm talking about worship based on who He is. He is always God. Amen? All my innermost being, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit. Anybody been redeemed in this place? Good, a few of you? Come on. It's okay if only a few of you praise, because the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And so I know that Pastor said this morning that not all praise is equal. Do we have anybody that's been redeemed from the pit in this room? God reached in a long ways to get me. I don't know about you, but he found me deep in the trash can of life. Forget not that God did that. And who not only pulls you out of the pit, but then crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Now, this ought to be a good word for this house, because this is the house of the hairpiece and the mohawk in the same place. It's the house of the walker and the skateboard. People dyeing their hair to look cool, and people dyeing their hair to look normal. Come on, we just all together. This ought to make everybody shout, man. Who doesn't want to be renewed like the youth? Come on. I seen we got some young. We don't have old people here. We have young at heart people here. In the kingdom, we don't retire, we refire. Amen. I seen some young at heart people up here out shaking the youth. I seen them out dancing, out praising the youth in this thing. And we have a promise from our God that God is going to renew us like the eagles. Isaiah 40:27 says this: why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? I wish I had time, but he's talking to the same guy, calling him two different names. My way is hidden from the Lord, and my just claim is passed over by my God. Have you not known? Say, why do you keep saying my way is hidden from the Lord, and God is passed? Have you ever looked at God and said, God, I think you forgot me? Not you, huh? That's somebody else. Have you not known? Have you not heard? He is the everlasting God, the Lord, the creators of the ends of the earth. He neither faints nor grows weary. His understanding is unsearchable, unsearchable. Touch your neighbor and say, it's unsearchable. So stop trying to figure it out. Verse 29, he gives power to the weak. And to those who have no might, he increases their strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary. Even young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait upon the Lord, come on, if you know the rest, shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Wow, come on. I want to take a few moments to preach a message that I've entitled tonight, second wind. Second wind. Come on, touch your neighbor and say, you're about to get a second wind. I have a follow-up title to this, my secondary title. Sometimes I can't decide on which one I like more. It's in smaller writing. It just says this: you may have to get down to get up. You may just have to get down to get up. Second wind. I recently started doing this thing called CrossFit. I don't believe there is any cross in CrossFit, at least the modern cross of awesomeness, but I believe it's more like the death chamber that Jesus went to. For 30 to 45 minutes, my coach, I love him and hate him all at the same time, he takes me to hell and back. We've read books about people that have been to heaven and back. I've been to hell and back a few times. And man, it's just horrible. I mean, hours of just feeling like I'm going to die. And so, I'm not quite there yet, but I'm not where I used to be. I'm not where I want to be, but I'm not where I used to be. And it's been getting better as time goes on. But the first 3 weeks, I couldn't walk upstairs. I had to crawl after the sessions because my legs were hurting so bad. And if you've never done CrossFit, you have no clue what I'm talking about. Go try it for one day, and you will relate to a brother up here. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, I'm just a creative guy. And so I noticed that as long as I was the worst in the class, that my coach would pick on me the most. And so I don't like to lose. I knew I couldn't be first, so I just decided I don't want to be last. So I would purposely invite people to class. They thought I was just being nice or friendly or a good pastor or that I had chose them, which I had, selected them, hand-selected them for certain reasons that they could be the chosen last one and I would be second to last, which would get my coach's eyes off me and on them. So I picked this one guy, Andy. I had picked several different young guys, and I made the mistake of that because although they were out of shape being young, within 3 weeks they were in better shape than me eating pizza and donuts on the way to CrossFit. So I decided to pick someone that was a little older than me and a little more out of shape. Well, he is in a certain shape, just not in the shape he wants to be. Amen. And so his name's Andy, and so he would come. He's one of the dads in our church. And so we were out working out on the beach, and you know, all the young guys are running, and one of the young guys, his goal is to get to the pier and back, and by the time he gets back, we can stop running, so we're cheering him on. I don't know if I'm going to make it to the pier or even make it close, but I was hanging out with the second to last crew, and you know, here's Andy, and I'm praying for him. I'm praying he doesn't have a heart attack in the process because this will be my fault. And so as we're running, I noticed Andy way in the distance, and I felt good about myself. I felt like I had achieved something. I felt like I wasn't last. Amen. And I'm running back. The young guy crosses us and passes, and thank God we got the turn back. I don't even have to make it to the pier. And so as we're running back, I feel Andy is in the back, and I kind of look back at him every once in a while. And as I'm looking back at him, I've noticed that he's gaining speed on us. He's not supposed to do that because he's supposed to be last, so I can be second to last. And pretty soon he catches right up to me, and I kind of start talking to him, try to throw him off, maybe trip him or whatever I got to do. I said, Andy, what are you doing? Hey, he goes, I don't know. About half a mile back there, something hit me. I said, what hit you? Are you doing drugs again? Or are you... did you bring something illegal here to make it to beat me? And he said, something hit me. I said, what hit you? He goes, I forgot to tell you this. In high school, I used to run cross country. I said, oh no. I said, what do you mean? He said, there's this thing in running. It's called the second wind. And as he passes me, he goes, and I got my second wind. I said, wait. What he was saying is somewhere in the middle, Not at the beginning, not quite at the end. Somewhere where you feel like you're going to die and you feel like you can't make it any further, there is this supernatural thing that doctors still can't explain called the second wind. If they could bottle it up, they could inject it into athletes, they'd give it to them at the beginning because it would make them super athletes. Because when you get the second win, you're actually better than your first win. But you can only get it at the end of your first win. You can only get it when you run out of breath and you decide, I don't know if I could go any further, but something else takes over and you take one more step. I came to talk to some people that feel like you're at the end of your first wind and you don't know if there's any more in you, that God is sending a second wind to this house. You may be last right now, baby, but God is about to change the game on you. He's about to renew your strength like the eagles. He's about to put something new inside you. I don't know who I came to preach to tonight, but there are some people in this room. The devil invited you so you'd be last, but he had no clue who you were before the earth touched you, before they named you. God had put a runner inside you, a champion inside you, a winner inside you. And he's already crowned you in the middle. Second wind. But to understand the second wind, we have to understand the first Adam. God created the sun, the moon, the stars, hung the planets where he wanted. People say, do you think God could be creative? I don't know, this church is kind of creative. And I said, well, in the beginning, God created. That's the first thing he did. But he didn't create with his hands, he's created with his mouth. He just started speaking. You got to be careful if you're God, because whatever you speak about, all of a sudden it starts becoming. God started speaking and planets formed and solar systems came to be. They're still forming because his word is never ending. It keeps going and declaring itself and compounding upon itself. We build a bigger telescope and we find another billion stars in our solar system. Oh, wow, there's another billion stars there. A billion. How did you miss a billion stars? I'm nervous. And as they build bigger telescopes, they'll find more stars. Because our God is bad. You know, we create off of what we saw last week or last month or last year. There's nothing new under the sun. But God didn't create off of anything. He had no blueprint to follow, no people to help him. He all by himself spoke and things came to pass and didn't come to pass half or stick figure. He spoke and things were 3D, scratch and sniff. You could smell it, taste it, touch it, feel it. God put things inside of things that we're still discovering. The greatest thing he put inside of something was a seed. Because the seed kept going. Every time you plant it, something else comes about. But the greatest seed he ever planted was Adam. And when he made Adam, he stopped speaking. And he kneeled down into the dirt. God formed the first man with dirt. He unlocked something great with dirt. Oh, God's still working in the dirt today. Your dreams are a seed that are unlocked with dirt. There's something about the dirt that unlocks the seed. And God formed Adam with the dirt and he stood up and he looked good. But God wasn't done just forming him. This is why our greatest need is to be touched by God again. Because it's where Adam started. God didn't just form Adam or speak to him or prophesy to him. God breathed his breath into him. Adam breathed back. That's why every day when you wake up and you breathe your breath back out, you're worshiping God one more day. Let everything that has breath praise God. The Lord. Why? Because every breath that you get is a breath from God. God breathed into Adam, and Adam breathed back. But the enemy stole his breath. God pulled the first bride out of Adam. He pulled out his rib. This is why men like ribs. You've been wondering this whole time. Now I just helped you out. This is formed his bride with this rib. And Adam lost his breath. He lost his authority. He lost his ability to breathe back out. And ever since, man's been trying to catch his breath until the second Adam. His name was Jesus. The second Adam, watch, on the cross. It was a tree again, but this tree that brought death would now bring life. And now the fruit of heaven hung on this tree. The fruit of life. And the guard pierced his side, and water and blood flowed, and he pulled out the second bride, the church. And then in Acts chapter 2, the upper room, God breathed the second wind on the second bride. He breathed on the church again, and we got our breath back. See, God wants to breathe again into this church. He wants to breathe again into this city. See, the power that we have does not just come from standing up. It comes from breathing back out that breath that God puts in us. The Bible says those that wait upon the Lord. So I used to think this is like this kind of waiting. Whenever you're ready, God. I mean, this would be nice. I could really use a change right now. It's frustrating. I guess I'm just waiting. What are you doing? I'm just waiting on God. I guess he's just busy or has a problem. Can't solve mine. He's working on theirs. But this word to wait is more like a waiter. It's different. If you have a waiter this afternoon that's sitting like this while you're trying to eat, your water's down, you're like, could you get us some water? You think that waiter's getting a tip? Oh, waiter. The best waiters at finest restaurants. Sir, what can I do? Okay, it looks like your water is half empty. They don't even ask. They just start filling it up. Their life is about focusing on you. Those that wait upon the Lord. Look, while the Lord isn't working, it doesn't mean he's not working. He may not be working on your situation. He may be working on you. And he's saying, are you going to wait on me on this time? Those that wait upon the Lord will be renewed like the eagles, the eagles, the eagles, the eagles. I came to talk to some eagles tonight. I didn't come here to talk to any chickens. I came to talk to the eagles tonight. Do we have any eagles in the room tonight? The eagles here will be renewed like the eagles. In the Bible, over 38 times, God references this animal, the eagle. You see, the number one thing, first thing I want to tell you about the eagle is that eagles were built for the storm. Eagles were built for the wind and the lightning and the thunder and the rain. Eagles, while other birds are hiding in their nest, while other birds are finding any place they can to shelter themselves when the rain comes out and the wind comes out and the storms start to rage. It's the eagle that God calls us. It's the eagle that we're going to be renewed like. It's the eagle that climbs to the top of the mountain and sticks out what God's given it. It's the eagle, while everyone else is hiding, that knows the storm is the best time to take flight. It's the eagle that when everyone else is hiding, it comes to the edge of the cliff and it opens up its worship to the God that created it and said, this storm, because the eagle knows that the pressure of the storm. See, the eagle knows that without the storm, it will have to flap to take off. It will have to work to get up high. But it's in the storm that when the eagle sticks out what it has, it's the storm that does the work. I came to talk to some people that are in storms right now because you thought that that storm was sent to kill you. You thought that God was mad at you, so he let down the walls. And now everything's coming against you. But I came to serve notice on the devil and tell him and remind you that you are an eagle. You were built for this moment. You were designed for this hour. All you have to do is stick out what God gave you and let the storm push you to another level. Yeah. What is Daniel without the lions? What is Jesus without Judas? What is David without the giant? The giant wasn't sent to take David out. It was sent to motivate him to be king. Even Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know what happened when they got out of the fire? They got the highest positions in the land because the king saw that they didn't operate alone. That if they can get through that kind of fire, they can get through this kind of fire. Can I tell you this? God doesn't want to save you out of the fire. He wants to save you in it. He wants to transform you in the storm. Maybe today you'll have to worship with your wounds. Praise with your problems. Maybe today we could trade sadness for joy. Maybe today we're going to have to look at our soul and say, praise him, oh my soul, because he has never left me, he has never forsaken me, and he's going to get me through this storm just like he got me through the last storm. Eagles are built for the storm. You were made for this. You were designed for this. How do I know? Because you're still here. If you weren't made for this, see, God is more to me like an architect than a cabinet maker. They said that Jesus was a cabinet maker. I think he was more like an architect because he pre-planned who he would be before he came into this earth. He designed his back that would handle the whips. He designed the tree before it was a seed that he would hang on. He designed the greatest prison break. So you are a design of God. You were a blueprint in God's heart before you were a person on this earth. In my city, there's earthquakes. So if you're going to build a building downtown, you got to design it for the environment it's going to exist in. In fact, the new buildings, they build wheels on the bottom so that when earthquakes come, it can move and shift and not touch the building. They design it for what's coming against it. Your God designed you for this moment. Your God designed you to get through, to make it through. You see, anybody else living your life would have went crazy with what you dealt with. But you're still here. You ought to throw yourself a birthday party and say, hallelujah, Jesus, because I'm still here. Devil, you should have had me back when, but I'm still praising Jesus, even in the middle of the storm, even in the middle of the pain. Number one, eagles are built for the storm. You were built for this. Number two, eagles are known for their vision. And it's the storm that propels them even greater vision. It's the storm that lifts them to helicoptic vision. It's the storm that takes them to new elevation, that gives them new vision. This is what I can say, is that life in it seems really difficult. But life looking back on it, sometimes you go, thank God for that pain I went through. Thank God that you allowed that to happen, because if it wasn't for that, I couldn't be who I am today. See, when you look back on things, you are looking at it with a new elevation from the place the storm has lived. Look, the object, we keep praying for the object to change. God, change this. Take this away. Transform this. And God's not going to change the object. He wants to change your vision of the object. See, God hasn't removed fear out of my life. It still barks. It still yaps. But I've just learned from a new elevation, the barking is not a pit bull. It's a chihuahua. Elevation takes you to a new place. You have the same eyes. The object doesn't change. But God moves you to a new location. Eagles are known for their vision. In fact, in the Native American tribes, the most coveted feather is an eagle feather. And the only way you can have an eagle feather is through bravery. Not everybody gets to wear the feather, because the feather represents the vision of the house. And the only way you have a lot of vision is if you've been through some stuff and you've made it to the other. So young warriors will find arrows and they'll bring it to their chief. Because they believe as long as the chief has vision, that other tribes will look just at his vision and be threatened by what they would do to them. But in the church today, we got Chief Crazy Horse and Lone Rider so-and-so. I know you got a vision, Pastor, but I'm holding on to this vision for myself. I got a vision of how the church should run. I don't know about you, Pastor, and the devil ain't afraid of nothing. Or we've plucked out our vision. We have a lot of churches where pastors have no vision. Leaders have no vision. People that come to church have no vision. Well, then I would say we have a whole bunch of turkey vultures. Turkey vultures look like eagles, have the ability to fly like eagles. But there's one thing different. It's their head. They have no feathers on their head because they don't need them. They were born with them, but they pluck them out. Because their food is the carcasses of dead animals. It's not a convenience to stick your head in with feathers because you're always having to clean them off. The Bible says where the dead things are, the vultures will gather. See, I came to talk to some eagles. They're not feeding off of dead things. They're not feeding off of who they used to be, who they should be. Or what about some eagles that are not feeding off of fear from last week that God already killed on the cross, or anxiety that he already put on the cross? See, there's been seasons in my life where I've pulled my feathers out and I've stuck my head in dead things, and I start smelling like the dead things I've stuck my head in. And I lose my vision. But God is wanting to grow back the feathers of this generation. He's wanting to grow back the vision of this generation. He's wanting to give you back what he died to give you in the first place. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I need you to get a vision. Because vision brings purpose to pain. Remember when you were 5 and it happened? It pulled out life. You had a pitcher, but the pitcher was broken. Remember the last church you went to? And it all fell apart. The last leader you trusted. The last vision that you said, okay, God, I'll go with you. I'll believe. I'll trust. Remember the last time you prayed when you were sick? So we end up in life and we end up with a whole bunch of pieces. We want a picture, but all we really have is a piece. So we settle for the peace. We try to talk about the peace, but it's not really that exciting. So we just kind of shut down and stop talking altogether. And we just live with the broken pieces, because this is just life. This is just how it is. It's just what God handed me. He could have stopped it, but he didn't. And then we think we'll fix it. So we think the best thing we need for a man is a woman. She's pretty. She's got a lighthouse and a sunset on her. And we sing this song, dun, dun, da, dun, 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 da, dun, you are dun, dun, da, dun, dun, da, dun, dun, da, dun. And a microphone drops out and say, let's get ready to rumble! Because she goes, hey, I know I look good. Welcome to the party. And if you're like me, you're trying to put her together. She's a mess. And she's trying to put you together. Because you're definitely a mess. And the puzzle keeps working on the puzzle. And the puzzle never can put itself back together again. So eventually we just have kids. We mix them together. Good luck. That's what I have. I didn't even know what it was. I think it's like a horse or something. I've heard. Some of us are this kid. We don't even know where the box is. We don't even know if all the pieces are here. This is why you have to start with vision. And you can't put you together. I can't put me together. I have to start with the one who saw the picture before it was broken. It starts with vision, because vision gives purpose to pain. Oh, I see where that piece fits. It's right over here. Oh, I had to go through that. You know why you had to go through that? Because if I just had a picture of a lighthouse, no one would care. But it's if I could put this 500-piece puzzle together, then everybody is not awed by the picture. They're awed not by the piece, but by the master of the piece. An eagle will make sure who she gets with has vision. And not only has vision, can handle her vision. Look, people just say, man, it's just great if we just have chemistry. If you put too many chemicals together, in my chemistry class, you have an explosion. And it's called the bachelor. Amen. You know what I'm saying? My wife keeps watching that. I'm like, this is killing me. This is the weirdest show. They find the weirdest people in the world and put them on this thing and just hope they explode, and it's just awesome. That's what we do in life. We're playing chemistry chemicals, and swipe right if you like someone and swipe left if you don't. And a female eagle will make sure she's got the right guy. She will come in. He'll come in. His bird dance. Look at me. She's not moved by his dance. She wants to see how he can handle the storm. Yeah, don't watch how he worships when it's going good. Watch how he worships when he stubs his toe. And she'll take the man up with her beauty. And on the way up, she's grabbed a twig in her mouth. She'll take him up to thousands of feet in the air, and out of nowhere, when he thinks he's just checking her out, she'll drop the twig. Twig will fall fastly to the ground, and the male eagle knows his job. He better get that twig. He'll swoop down as fast as he can to rescue the twig out of the air, take it back up to her. She'll grab it out of his mouth and fly 1,000 feet higher. She'll do this 15 times to test, can you handle the twig? I say she's doing it because she wants to make sure that she does not procreate with chickens. Ladies, you need to make sure he can get on your level. Men, you need to make sure she can get on your level. You need to make sure that she can soar where God has called you to soar, and he can soar where God's called him to soar. She'll take him up because of what's coming in the future. My third point is that the same place that an eagle will make you comfortable, a mother eagle will make you uncomfortable. They build their nest high in rocks. They do not work in trees. If you put it in a tree, it's too big, too powerful, too strong. In fact, one eagle's nest, I said this at another place, and they said, oh, that can't be right. So I went and researched it. I'm like, oh, actually, it was right. One eagle's nest they found built was 9 feet wide and 20 feet deep. Not the opposite, 9 feet wide and 20 feet deep. The reason why they put depth is the mother eagle will fly around her environment and pick different twigs and branches and feathers from herself and different things, and she'll prepare the nest. And as she prepares the nest, She has, that's why it's so deep, because each layer she puts something new. She puts feathers on one layer, but the next layer she'll put thorns. Then rocks and stones and then feathers again. Because as she's building, she wants to make sure that the eagles that she will birth won't die where they're born. And as she feeds them, she chews things up and she feeds them. Her ultimate goal is not to keep them where they're born, but to propel them to where they're going. She'll chew up food. She'll hunt it down and feed them and feed them. And as they gain weight and as they gain width and gain height, they start sinking in the nest. They, at first, they're at the top, and slowly they start sinking in this nest. And pretty soon, all they see is the nest. All they're used to is the nest. They've almost forgot what the outside world looks like. But at a certain point, as they grow, there will be a pain that comes. A thorn in the midst of the feathers. A rock in the midst of the soft brush she's laid down. And the mother does this because she does not want the eaglet to get comfortable in the place it was born. Because the same place an eaglet will get comfortable, its mother will make it uncomfortable. Pretty soon the eaglet, if it gets uncomfortable enough, will start pushing its way to the top of the nest again. We'll wonder, why in the world would mom ever put these kind of things in this safe place? I used to love this environment, but now I'm irritated by it. Some of us are praying for an environment to change, but God's actually trying to eject you out of the environment. Some of you are praying for a boyfriend to change, but he ain't going to change, baby. God's trying to make you uncomfortable in the same place you used to be comfortable. Some of you used to be comfortable with a certain group of friends and are now very uncomfortable with that same group of friends. And you're thinking, oh, maybe they changed. No, God is growing you. Look, some of us think that when we become uncomfortable, we went backwards. You're uncomfortable in your job, not because we need your job to change, because we need you to realize that you are supposed to own the next company that you work for. We keep praying for things to change and they keep not changing. They keep getting worse because God is making you uncomfortable in a place you were never meant to live. You were born there, but it's not where you're staying. And pretty soon the eaglet will get pushed out of the nest. And then the mother, as soon as it gets out of the nest, will take her beak and push it off the cliff. The eaglet will fall almost to his death, thousands of feet down. And then the twig comes back in. Because the husband eagle has done this before. He could handle the twig so he gets to handle her kids. He can handle the minimal so he gets to handle her future. And the father eagle, isn't it awesome? The Father God is the one that always rescues us. The father eagle will swoop. Isn't it awesome that Holy Spirit always pushes us out of the nest? And the father eagle will swoop down, and right before the eaglet's about to die, pick it back up. Carry it back to the top of the mountain. Oh man, safe up here. This is great. Man, mom is crazy. I don't know what's happening here. I don't know what Holy Spirit's doing here. And all of a sudden, Holy Spirit. Pfft. The eagle will do this 15 to 30 times until the eaglet finally catches. Well, what's this? What's this thing over here? I didn't know I had this. And all of a sudden, somewhere in the drop zone, somewhere in the falling, somewhere where it thinks it's going to die, something new comes into place that was always there. And the eaglet starts flapping what it always had and realizes that mom and dad weren't trying to hurt you. They were trying to propel you into the destiny you were called to. I came to talk to some people that feel like you're falling right now. I came to talk to some people that feel like you're flapping right now. I came to talk to some people that God put more in you than you realize is inside of you. I came to talk to some world changers right now. No, you're not normal. You're not average. You're not mediocre. You're not going to die in the place you were born. God has more for you. He did not resurrect you from the dead spiritually for you to sit idle for the rest of time. No, God has a destiny and a plan and a purpose. And all you got to do, wow. What if there are environments that you have not yet got to explore? Can you imagine the day the eaglet goes from not even knowing it can fly to realize this was here the whole time? Can you imagine the new adventure that waits in front of it? Finding out the only environment it thought it was going to live in was this small nest, to find out that the skies were open to it, that there is more out there. I wonder if right now what you thought was life, oh, God's about to blow your entire mind to what you thought was your whole world, and it was just the nest. What does God have for you beyond the nest? But many people sit in church and say things like this. Oh, I'm here at your new church because I was at the last church and the pastor wasn't feeding me. You know what they're saying? I'm still in the nest. What do you got that you're going to chew up and spit in my mouth? I'm here for Sunday. No, eagles hunt live things. That's why the word is alive. It's alive. Why? Because you can. Because God designed you for this. I love that when you start hunting your enemy, you do not operate on the same zone as your enemy. You have now been given a new ability to fly where your enemy cannot see you. What God is doing in you is He's preparing you for battle. He doesn't just want to be a warrior. He wants to show you that He's put a warrior inside of you. The eagle picks up its enemy and it brings it to the top of the cliff. Ah. If you're struggling with something, just take it up. If you're working through something, just take it up through worship. If you're walking through something, just take it up. Take it higher, because your enemy was not made to survive where you're about to go. You put the enemy under your feet. And all you got to do is let go in the environment you're in. All you got to do is go up higher in worship and let go of what's been holding on to you. And when you let go, yeah, I love that the enemy of the eagle is the snake, but it's also the thing it eats. Doesn't the Bible say, resist the enemy and he will flee? Some of you just got to let go. You just got to let go in this new environment God's brought you to. You got to let go of that thing you brought up here. Because now when you release it, it's going to destroy it. And the eagle, as the band comes, has to go through a process to get to its promise. Has to go through a process to get to its promise. The eagle either lives to 60 years old or lives to 120. Based on its choice at 60. At 60 years old, the eagle's talons become dull. Its beak becomes curved. Its feathers become weighted. And the eagle is found at 60 years old many times on the floors of where it used to soar over. And the eagle in those moments is stuck remembering the exploits of the past, wanting to get to them. But I've been too far to go back there. I've been through too much. I feel too tired. Just remembering the good old days. And it's in that moment that the eagles that have made the choice to go through the process to get to the promise start showing up to protect that eagle. As predators would come, and food would be scarce because it no longer has the ability to hunt. Eagles will come and treat it like it's an eaglet again. Grabbing meat that it knows about and feeding it to them again. You see, some of you don't realize that sometimes in life we go through a process. If you've been a general at one time, you will get tired. And at that point, the ego has to make a choice. Do I humble myself and eat this like a child again? Or do I die here? Is this all God has? See, I really believe that this church is a church that ministers to those eagles. We call them the snowbirds, right? You know, When I come to this church, I see the young people fired up, but I see the young at heart fired up. Something inspires me about that. Something says that they're in that place of eating again. Oh, man, I remember what this was like when I was a teenager. I remember what the Holy Ghost felt like. I remember what the presence of God felt like. It's not over. There's more that God has. There's a greater awakening. Some of you have lived through revivals that you've seen in the past, and you've watched the gospel get watered down, and you're ready for the fire to be stirred again. And something inside of you is longing for more as you watch these eagles come and surround you and feed you again and say, here's one more word. Here's one more word. God has more. God has more. The eagle has to make a choice at that moment. And if it makes the choice, its first journey is back up the mountain. And it will fight back up the mountain. It'll take its beak. But the mountain is actually, it thinks the struggle is about getting up the mountain, but the struggle is actually sharpening what's gotten dull. With each step, the beak gets sharper. And when it gets back to the top of the mountain, it will usually go back to the birthing stone, the place where it was born. And in that place, it will take its sharp beak and rip out all of its feathers, all the vision it had from the first section of life. And all you can see in the eagle would be the scars of battles and wars and things that it had fought to get there. Then the eagle will rip out its beak. It will rip out every talent. And it will wait. Because as it waits, those that wait upon the Lord, as it waits, something begins to happen in the waiting as it feels awkward and doesn't feel like itself, and all it has is its pain there. Something begins to show up daily. All of a sudden, a feather starts. And the new feathers are given something that the first feathers aren't given. Underneath an eagle that is over 60, they will develop pouches under their arms to put oil onto their feathers. There is a new level of anointing that comes, that when they get into trouble, things just fall off them now. There's a new level of anointing when you go, God, I'm not dying here. I'm not quitting here. I've been through some stuff. I've walked through some things. But whatever I got to go through, whatever process I got to walk through, I know on the end of this, I'm going to be stronger than the beginning. Isn't that what the anointing is? Every single ingredient was crushed, burned, broken, or beaten. When David got the anointing poured over his body, he was signing up for brokenness just as much as kingship. But to the level that you're broken will be the level that God could put you back together. Take the pieces and reveal the master of the piece. I came to talk to some eagles tonight. I came to talk to some eagles tonight. I came to talk to some people that you might be in a process right now. You might be in the middle of sitting in your nest, the place you were born, feeling like you haven't advanced much. No vision left. I came to talk to the Samson church. I came to tell Samson that his hair grew back. I came to talk to the Samson church and say, your hair's growing back. Your wings are growing back. Your feathers are growing back. God is not finished with you. He's just getting started. 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 He's ready to renew Jesus. Renew Jesus. Renew Jesus. Come on, if you're receiving that word tonight, I want you to stand up and lift up your hands. He's wanting to renew you. He's wanting to restore you. He's renewing you. Renew, 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 renew. If you're in this room and you have broken vision, something didn't work out that you wanted to work out, and now you're feeling uncomfortable in the same place you used to feel comfortable with. I want you to come down to this front. I believe as you begin to walk down, God is going to begin to restore you. He's going to begin to restore you. You've been waiting on the Lord wrong, and tonight we're going to wait on Him different. We're going to serve. We're going to worship at His feet. We're going to lift up our hands in the middle of the storm. You say, I'm in the middle of that storm. I've been hiding in my nest, and I'm ready to come stand on the edge of the rock and lift up what God has given me. God, thank You for these winds. Thank You for the rain. Thank You, Father, for the pain. Thank You, Father. Thank You that You entrusted me, God. You built something in me that's bigger than what I'm walking through. Thank You, God, that I'm still here. If you're in this room and you feel like you're on the bottom of that floor, and what you used to chase down, you're having to be fed now. What used to make perfect sense, now God's having to, He's having to almost spoon feed you. But you want to make the choice tonight. You know what? Whatever the process is, God, whatever it is, I want to live to the greater thing You have more. I want my second wind. If you're in this room and you need a second wind, would you lift up your hands to heaven tonight? I believe the Holy Ghost is going to blow through this place and do what only the Holy Ghost can do. And He's going to give this room a second wind, a second wind, a second wind, a second wind. That second wind is the power of the Holy Ghost. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Spirit, I believe God wants to baptize a room right now. I believe God wants to give you another feeling of the baptism of the Holy Ghost if you already have one. Would you lift up your hands all over this room? Father, we thank You, Jesus, for what You're doing tonight. We thank You for the vision You're giving us. We thank You, Father, Lord, that we are not stuck in this nest, that we are not stuck on that ground. Lord, that You are restoring a new glory to Your people, a new ability, God, a new dream, a new vision, Father. Lord, thank you, Father, for the pastors of this house that are willing, God, to believe for another 60 years with people, that life isn't over. Life is just beginning. Father, thank You, Father, for making the young eaglets in this room uncomfortable in places they used to be comfortable in. Father, push us out of the nest. Push us off the cliff. Teach us to fly. Teach us to soar, Father. God, we thank You. What we're going to do right now is we're just going to worship. We're going to lift up our wings and we're going to praise. We're going to praise like we did this morning. We're going to worship. And we're going to worship with our wounds. We're going to praise through our problems. We're going to sing through our sorrow. We're going to dance through our drought. Come on, right here, right now. Come on, eagles. I want you to put up your wings.